Do you ever wonder what it takes to do software preservation? Well, if so, today is your lucky day because we are going to go through the trials and tribulations to try and archive multiple versions of the famous word processor, WordStar. You might be surprised to find that this little dive into history would ultimately involve DOS, disk surgery, and a Commodore 128. As usual, this is your host, NCommander, and today, we're spinning some floppy disks. Now, if you've been a fan of my channel, this might look familiar. In fact, I did a 5-hour live stream on the topic, and that led to the birth of what I am tentatively calling NCommander in real time. The idea is simple. I start with a live stream and complete a project on air, and then afterwards, use that footage to create a more edited video as an experiment in content creation. These real-time videos are meant to let me cover a larger variety of topics and act as a supplement to my normal long-form videos. With that lengthy introduction aside, let's get down to business. Sitting on my desk are three separate copies of WordStar, specifically versions 3 and 4 for CPM 80 and WordStar 2000 Release 3 for DAWs in nice bound boxes. Meanwhile, sitting on top of my desktop computer are two 5.25 drives connected via SuperCard Pro. Now, I intend to do a more in-depth video on magnetic flux preservation, but the very short version is that this step allows me to essentially make a magnetic photocopy of each disk and is generally the gold standard in floppy disk preservation. For 5.25-inch disks specifically, it's important that the disk and drive type match. That is why I have both double density and high density drives connected. The chat decided to have me start with WordStar 2000. Magnetic flux dumping is a somewhat fiddly process and it can take several attempts to get a successful dump even with good drives and good media. Strangely, my first attempt at dumping the disk got me this ever-filled mess, which made me wonder if the disk or drive had simply given up the ghost. I did eventually find the problem. These are double density disks and not high density like I had assumed. The confusion is understandable though. As a rule of thumb, you can generally tell the type of disk by looking at it visually. Double density 5.25 disks tend to have an inner reinforcement ring, which high density disks lack. I'm going to emphasize the word generally because it turns out that MicroPro used diskettes that lack the ring. Once PassMe had figured out what had gone wrong, it was a simple enough fix. Not long after, I had all 15 disks properly dumped. Sorta. As I would realize after the fact, I actually made a mistake and didn't save the manufacturing tracks correctly, so I ended up dumping these disks again off stream. That tangent aside, there was still the matter of validating that I had indeed made good dumps. Personally, I don't consider a disk dump successful until I'm able to install and use whatever I am saving. I hadn't seen any copy protection in place, so I converted the images to flat files and then loaded up DAWs in an emulator. After figuring out how to start the installation process, it didn't take long until I was at a C prompt with everything installed. I suppose it's not too surprising that I was able to load up WordStar 2000 without issue at this point. Now, while I intend to do a more in-depth video on WordStar in the future, I quickly realized that WordStar 2000 has relatively little similarity to the older versions that are more fondly remembered. From my brief impressions, it seems that this product could be best described as WordStar in name only. That being said, the main objective has been achieved. I still needed to archive the component disks, but chat was getting a bit restless to go to the CPM versions, so I decided to switch gears. Chat voted to dump WordStar 3 next. These are single-sided double-density disks, and there's some quirks dealing with CPM disks that I will get into as we go along. Unfortunately, this is also where things start going downhill, and that I would learn a few lessons on how best to preserve floppies. The biggest problem was that I didn't notice that the WordStar 3.0 disks had warped slightly, and the disk cookie was not spinning freely in its jacket. During the attempted dump, the drive was making what I could best describe as a rubbing sound. I had experienced this before with disks that were marginal, but had managed a successful dump in those cases, so after some debate, I decided to let the disk dump run through and hope for the best. To be honest, this worked better than it should have, and I got a partial disk image. That being said, from the visual graph, it was clear that something had gone wrong. A closer examination of the disc showed scratches in the outer ring of the cookie. I am not certain the scratches were there before or not, but the other two discs do not have them. Now, I knew that this version of WordStar had been archived, so I decided to experiment a bit to learn techniques for the future. As I see it, if the disc ended up getting shredded, nothing irreplaceable had been lost, and I would learn something in the process. After a few minutes of debate, I came up with a plan of action. The first was to disconnect the double density drive and clean the drive heads. This would make sure that the disc had not left any dirt or grime during the attempted read. There was a small black speck when I ran a Q-tip over the drive heads, which was a bad sign that the disc was delaminating and disintegrating. By this point, I had noticed that the disc was indeed warped, and one solution to that problem was to remove the disc cookie from its sleeve and transplant it into another. I had never tried this, but I had figured it was worth a shot. I have a bunch of blank high-density discs, and I chose one of them to use as a donor. A few snips with the scissors, and that, as they say, is that. I then repeated the process with the WordStar disc. Unfortunately, I accidentally nicked the edge of the disc cookie. Since there's a fair bit of gap space, this wasn't necessarily fatal, but it is a reminder that I need to be more careful in the future. Once out, I cleaned the disc surface with isopropyl alcohol, put the Frankenstein disc into the drive, and crossed my fingers. I'd love to tell you that this worked, but well, I think the picture speaks for itself. After removing the Frankenstein disc, I could see visual damage to the disc cookie and parts where light was visible. The disc had literally started disintegrating in the drive. I spent the next half an hour removing the gunk left on the drive read heads. Needless to say, this was a frustrating experience. I think, in hindsight, had I realized that the disc was warped, I could have probably saved this disc. Since WordStar 3 is well preserved as is, I'm not going to lose any sleep on this one, since I at least learned something from the experience. In truth, I still wanted to end on a high note, and thus it was time to strap WordStar Release 4, or CPM, to the disc dumping machine. Inside the installation kit, we had these amazing 8-inch floppy disks. Sadly, I don't have an 8-inch drive, or I would have dumped these bad boys. Instead, we'll have to be content with the smaller 5.25-inch disks. Time has separated the disk label from the disks, but otherwise they appear to be in good condition, and I made sure that each one could spin freely. Just like WordStar 2000, each Release 4 disc went into the SuperCard Pro, and this time all 6 discs were dumped successfully. However, because these are CPM discs, I still had a few more hurdles to climb. Without going into too much detail, CPM discs have what can be best described as compatibility problems. In short, CPM diskettes are essentially specific to a given machine. That means a disc for an Osborne 1 will not work in a K-Pro. There are exceptions to this rule, but in general, if I actually wanted to use the discs in an emulator, I needed to extract the files. To do that, there are the CPM tools utilities, which can essentially read most CPM disk images, but you still need to know the type of machine that these discs were for. Based on a hunch, I tried reading them as the Osborne 1 format, and that turned out to be the correct choice, and I was able to extract all the flat files. Now we just need to test these. There are numerous ways to emulate a CPM machine to test if this actually worked, but I decided to go with what is the most mediocre CPM machine ever, the Commodore 128. The reason for this? Well, it's because I own a 128, and I'm planning on doing videos about it. Sadly, I don't own a 1571 disk drive, which would have been a one-stop solution, and eBay prices can be best described as exorbitant. The honest truth is that CPM on the 128 is a very strange beast, and it's not done well in preservation. While the Vice Commodore emulator can indeed start CPM, it can't read MFM disks like a real 128 with a 1571 disk drive can. Instead, you need to load the files onto Commodore CPM's semi-unique GCR disk format. To do this, I used Vice to create a blank D71 image and then formatted it under CPM. I then used a very old package called CTools to copy the CPM files onto the D71 disk. I could then load WordStar up in Vice, but I was struggling to use it due to differences between a normal PC keyboard and a Commodore 128 keyboard. It was at this point that I wanted to end my inaugural stream on a high note, so I went and got my 128 and my 1702 monitor I use with it. I don't have any real Commodore disk drives, instead I just have a single SD2 IDC, which unfortunately has some major downsides, especially when used with a Commodore 128. To make a very long story short, the SD2 IDC does not support what is known as burst mode out of the box. In preparation for making an eventual video on the 128, I have modded my SD2 IDC to connect the SRQ line and have compiled a patched firmware for it. By running the Snoop program in C64 mode, I can see that I am indeed running the burst mode firmware. With the prep work done, it was time to switch to 80 comms mode and show why I haven't made that video on the 128 yet. Filming CRTs at the best of times can be difficult, and just to make things more complicated, I'm using an 80 columns composite cable, and on the 1702, the text is virtually illegible on camera. I did adjust the contrast as best I could, but I have already accepted the need to use a more modern display if I want acceptable results for a long form video. Still, I think this is good enough to get the point across. I had set up an auto-swap list file and then used my modded SD2 IDC to kick into CPM. Since we're using burst mode, we're dropped to the A prompt in about 7 seconds and I could then swap disks to WordStar and run WS to get to the main menu. To be honest though, I am still having some problems here. The backspace key is not working properly under WordStar 4, and even after W install and WS change, I could not convince WordStar to work properly despite having it correctly configured. I have run other CPM programs and even WordStar 3 on this machine without issue before, so I am not certain what the problem is, but that's a debugging session for another day. Still, I have reached my goal of installing the software I have archived, so I think we can call it good. I still need to scan the manuals, but unfortunately the magic smoke escaped my secondhand document scanner, so that is not an option for the moment. A friend of mine is seeing if he can get it going again, but until then, I think I need to save up and invest in a new one. With that all said, I think we can bring this first episode of NCommander in Realtime to a close. I'd love to hear your opinions below, both on this and on my live stream in general, and ask that you like and subscribe. I'd also recommend that folks check out the community page of my channel, where I am currently discussing the possibility of setting up Patreon or YouTube memberships for the channel with the intent on investing in better gear and embarking on more ambitious projects. Beyond that, if you're interested in checking out more live NCommander content, I do regular charity livestream events for the DEFCON 201 group, who I've linked in the description below. As usual, feel free to come join me on Discord and follow me on Twitter. Until the next time, this is NCommander signing off and wishing you all a pleasant day.